Good morning and welcome once again to the Grace Community Church virtual service. We are hoping that this is a blessing to you, and if it is, please drop us a note, let us know so we can continue making these. But for now, sit down, raise your voices, and sing your praises to God.
Father, we read about your character in the Bible, and we think about, Father, sometimes how we don't want to disappoint you. We don't want to anger you. Father, at the same time, we think about your character and how that strength, that ferocity is also like a hedge. It can be a hedge of protection if we ask for it. In these uncertain times, Father, we want to understand the fullness of your character, and we want to come boldly before you to ask for what we need, not in fear, not in secret, hiding our sin. We want to be vulnerable to you. And Father, we ask that you truly would protect your children so that we can continue to boldly worship you and boldly praise you in this land. Thank you, Father, again for the opportunity to do what we do, the worship team, Grace Community Church, how it's blessing the people, how it's growing. It's incredible. You are so generous and loving. And thank you again for your son, Jesus. We can never thank him enough for his sacrifice. In his holy name, we pray these things. Amen.
I'm in a war every minute. I know for sure I'll never win it. I am David up against Goliath, and it's a fight for my attention. Believe what I've
please join with me for today's offering prayer. Long, long time ago, I used to always feel really, really weird about asking about money in church. I did. Maybe it's because I grew up poor and I grew up Catholic, where poverty was held to be a virtuous thing. I don't know. I just know this, that I've seen that God controls all resource, all money. It's all His. Everything is His. He created this world. Anything that you've been able to achieve is because of Him. Whether you give to Him or not, it's between you and Him, not me and you. Bible says in Corinthians that God loves a cheerful giver, and that you should give to God because God gave to you. Now, you say, well, why should I give to Grace Church? Why? Well, you shouldn't if you feel that you shouldn't. You should if you feel that you should. If God is using this to help you and hopefully others around, then support it. If you feel that it's worthy, a worthy cause to support, then support it. I'm not out there begging. I'm out there simply saying that obviously it costs us to do these things. We don't charge for it. We don't say you can't listen to this until you pay your fee and then you can click on the link and then you can listen. We don't do that. It's out there free for anyone to listen to. And it's only because people who understand the value of supporting the Word of God and that it must be freely accessible to anyone that they support it because they can. So let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for those who do support the work of God on earth, whether it's through this church or any evangelistic outreach that you have put on our time, in our time. Help us, Lord, to always be cognizant of the fact that you have called us to a task to reach a world who does not know of your great love offered to all humanity through Jesus Christ's death on the cross. We pray that people would be attracted to Him, saved by Him, and redeemed by Him through our collaborative efforts together. Bless the people, bless their lives, bless them with health, bless them with peace, bless them with spiritual sustenance. In the name of Jesus, our Lord, amen. Good morning and welcome to part 6 of learning how to live in a pagan world as a believer in God. In this session, you're going to meet King Nebuchadnezzar when he comes to his conversion. Up to now, what you've seen is a pagan king who has conquered the whole world by his military genius and by his strategy. We've seen a king who comes to understand the Jewish people's God in a way that is distant. It's not personal. He sees that there is a power that is true from the Jewish God. But in this chapter, you're going to see him convert and become a believer in the one true God. And this is shown in metaphor, and it is shown in the book of Daniel in more than one way. The whole reason that God has you and I living in today's world as a believer is because there are many people who don't believe in God all around each and every one of you. And God intends for you to have an influence in their life. How? The way you live, the way you talk, the way you act and react to things and to situations, to crisis. That's what he puts you in the circles that you live in for. If you simply say, okay, God, this is my calling, this is my family, this is my circle of neighbors and coworkers and friends, this is my marriage, this is my husband, this is my wife, these are my kids, this is my situation, help me to be the person I need to be in this situation. You can win, it says in the book of Peter, speaking to Christian wives, you can win a rebellious husband who does not believe in the Lord simply by the way you live. So we could all learn from this. And hopefully in this, you'll see that God is able to do this. So Nebuchadnezzar is going to become a believer in the one true God. He states this, his kingdom is an eternal kingdom. This is Nebuchadnezzar himself speaking of God. His dominion endures from generation to generation. He comes to this understanding of the true nature of power and leadership. It is not simply in being the guy who beat everybody up on the block with his big army. It's coming to a place of acknowledgement of the one true God. So I've kind of entitled this in a subtitle, The Praise of a Pagan King. Here in the beginning of Daniel chapter 4 is a preface in this chapter, and the preface is written by King Nebuchadnezzar himself. He personally writes this preface. I like this because I think a lot of you should write down how God has come into your life. I've told this to other people who have since passed on, people of means who left a sizable estate. I said, look, you can leave all of the money behind to all of your family members, but what you really should leave to them is why you were blessed and why you came to know who God is. Because in the case of one man that I knew, he had nothing at all when he first started off in life. And as he gave his life over to the Lord and began to serve the Lord, he became more and more prosperous. And he was at the end of his life, and I told him, look, you know what? Because he told me, my kids, my grandkids, they don't follow the Lord. They're going to inherit a whole bunch of money, but they don't follow the Lord. So I told him, well, write down your testimony. Tell them you wouldn't get any of this. You wouldn't even be alive if it wouldn't been for the fact that God came into my life when I was a young man way out in the middle of nowhere on the eastern plains of northeastern New Mexico on a cowboy ranch. And he almost died there, but he turned his life over to the Lord. And so I said, write down and tell them why you became a believer and why God prospered you. And hopefully that'll have an influence in their life. So that's what Nebuchadnezzar is doing here. He's writing a little personal story and a biography of himself, an autobiography of, this is what I experienced as a human being on earth. I became this great king. I had all power. But something else happened to me. Watch. King Nebuchadnezzar, to all the peoples, nations, and men of every language who live in all the world. So he intends for this to be a multi-ethnic, multiracial, I don't like the term racial, I've never liked that term, a message to people from every people group. And that's the way the world is, right? There's people from all kinds of backgrounds, all kinds of ethnicities, and we need to be cognizant of them and try to reach out to them. May you prosper greatly. Remember, his kingdom encompasses all different kinds of people. And as a leader, if you're a leader, and if you become a leader, if God allows you leadership, there's so many different kinds of people in this world with all kinds of different needs, and we should be working for the benefit of all people. We really should. May you prosper greatly. It is my pleasure to tell you about the miraculous signs and wonders that the Most High God has performed for me. How great are his signs, how mighty his wonders. His kingdom is an eternal kingdom. His dominion endures from generation to generation. I want you to notice something in this statement. Before, in Nebuchadnezzar's statements about the God of the Jewish people, he says, your God, when he talks to Daniel, he says, their God, the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Here, he is not using the second person to talk about this. He's using first person. I want to tell you what the Most High has done for me. So he's come to a personal knowledge of the one true God. So this is the praise of the pagan king, this part of the chapter, fourth chapter of Daniel. Life is full of difficult challenges. No one can live this in this life and in this world without challenge. No one. All of us face stuff that sometimes we wonder where it's coming from and why. If you would simply say, okay, God, I am not exempt from all that happens in the world, from cancer, from heart attacks, from strokes, from financial setbacks, from divorce, from marriage, from remarriage, from kids, from betrayal to love, to success, to failure. All of the things that happen in life that's what life is. It's full of all kinds of ups and downs and blessings and problems. If we would just simply say, okay, God, help me in my life to do all that I can to be the person I need to be. So Nebuchadnezzar, he says this, I was at rest in my house. Everything was cool. I conquered the world. I was in good shape. I was flourishing in my palace. Then I saw a dream which made me afraid, and thoughts upon my bed and visions of my head troubled me. So I issued a decree that all the wise men of Babylon come before me, so that they might make known unto me the interpretation of the dream. Then came in the magicians, the astrologers, the Chaldeans, the soothsayers, and I told them the dream, but they could not make known the interpretation. So here it is again, same old thing, just like when we first met him. He had this nightmare dream, and Daniel came in and told him what it meant. So he does the same thing. And I kind of wonder if he's doing this again to remind everybody that there is a God, and he can interpret dreams and visions, and he can give us understanding into what's going on, but we actually need to believe, because most human beings think they can figure things out, they can fix things, they can resolve all things. But there are many things in this world that are too difficult for anybody. Look, notice what he says, they could not make known unto me the interpretation. Same thing, life has these difficulties, these challenges that confuses even the best experts that you can call upon. It's an interesting thing. Why call on a true prophet as the last choice? Why did he do this? He already knew from personal experience that Daniel was the one that came forward out of the first bad dream that he had. Why does he do this and call all of the other ones first? I think he did this on purpose, to demonstrate to everybody that there is one God who knows how to deal with that which is inexplicable, and that humans, with all of their understanding and all of their expertise, we have a certain degree of understanding, but we do have areas that we cannot figure out. And for some reason, humanity always thinks that they know how to figure everything out. When I listen to a lot of the so-called modern-day scientists and astrologers and astronomers, they might as well be astrologers, astronomers and geologists and physicists, they always talk like they know everything when they prognosticate or they issue forth their studies or their conclusions of things that they see out there or that they discover. They think that they've got it all figured out. There's no need for God. There's no need for an approach to a being that is beyond all human beings, who is above and superior to human intellect as any that anyone could even imagine. There's the notion that we don't need him. We don't need him to tell us about what's going on because we have figured everything else out. We are experts. We observe. We're scientific. We don't need you, God, to tell us anything. So please stop interfering in our world. We'll figure it out. So King Nebuchadnezzar calls everybody else, and none of them can figure it out again. And then, of course, he calls in the one that he called the first time at the end, right when it was at the last minute, right before the fuse hit the dynamite, Daniel. Finally, Daniel came into my presence, and I told him the dream. He is called Belshazzar. I named him after my God. But the spirit of the holy gods is in him. So Nebuchadnezzar is simply doing something here, I think. I can't say for sure because I can't ask him. He's already been in eternity for thousands of years. I think he's doing this because he knows that there's a lot of fakery out there. There's a lot of falsehood in religious and social belief, spiritual belief systems of humanity. And he's basically kind of drawing a line of demarcation between that which is true and that which is fake. I said, Belshazzar, chief of the magicians. Who made him chief? Well, he did. This king did. And he did it because he had interpreted a dream way, way back at the beginning. I know that the spirit of the holy gods is in you, and no mystery is too difficult for you. Here is my dream. Interpret it for me. Dreams can be pleasant, can have a really nice dream. I asked somebody the other day, so what kind of dreams do you have? Do you have the flying dreams? Oh yeah, I fly all over. I have the falling dreams, you know, those are the nightmare ones. Some people have real pleasant dreams, and a lot of people get up in the morning, oh, I dreamed this, I dreamed that. Dreams are difficult to understand. It's simply the resting of your brain and rewiring so that it can get ready for another day. So don't put too much stock in everything that you dream at night. Don't try to govern your life by that. I think we covered that in one of the earlier sermons in this book. These are the visions I saw while I was lying in my bed. This is different than the first dream because he didn't want to tell anybody what he dreamed. He wanted them to tell him what he dreamed. And everybody was askance and everybody was scandalized. And he says, oh, guess what? Because you guys can't tell me what I dreamed, you're all dead. So until somebody tells me, and Daniel's the one that did. So this time, though, he tells him the dream. I looked and there before me stood a tree in the middle of the land. Its height was enormous. The tree grew large and strong. Its top touched the sky. Sounds like a redwood, right? It was visible. If you've never seen the redwoods, you need to go visit them. That's one of the bucket list things that you should do. They're amazing. Thousands of years old trees. Giants. The tree grew large and strong, and its top touched the sky. It was visible to the ends of the earth. Its leaves were beautiful. Its fruit abundant. On it was food for all. Under it, the beasts of the field found shelter, and the birds of the air lived in its branches. And from it, every creature was fed. So that's his dream, okay? Part of his dream. But dreams can also have really dark kind of tinges to them. Some dreams are pleasant. A lot of dreams are nightmares. So this is now the dream kind of goes into a nightmare kind of a area. He continues explaining to Daniel, in the visions I saw while lying in my bed, I looked, and there before me was a messenger, a holy one coming down from heaven. This means an angel. He called in a loud voice, cut down the tree and trim off its branches, strip off its leaves, scatter its fruit, let the animals flee from under it, and let the birds flee from its branches. Dream is getting kind of dark. But let the stump and its roots bound with iron and bronze remain in the ground. So cut down this glorious tree, but let the stump remain. Let him be drenched with the dew of heaven. Notice the change in pronoun here. Instead of calling it a tree, now he says, let him be drenched with the dew of heaven. Let him live with the animals among the plants of the earth. Let his mind be changed from that of a man, and let him be given the mind of an animal, till seven times pass by for him. Interesting, don't you think? This is a scary, in a way, kind of a dream. You need to know something about life. Look, God is in total control. He really is in total control. When you come to this conclusion, it will give you peace. No matter what you face, you might face cancer, you might be facing something else, something that is really difficult, that you wonder, what's this all about? You need to settle in your heart once and for all, okay, God, if you want me to live or die because of this, it's your will. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Know and believe and have the personal conviction that God is totally in control. You and I cannot even control the time that we live in, our date of death. It is appointed unto man to die once and after the judgment. We are under the authority of a being called God. Your life is in his hands. Remember Daniel telling Nebuchadnezzar's son this later on in the next chapter? Your life is in his hands. God is in control unless you think you are. If you think you're in control, that's why you're all stressed out. That's why you're worried. That's why you're fretting, because you think that you have control. Well, you don't. You have control of certain things, control of the way you live your life, control of the way you act or react. You do have, given by God, certain parameters of control. But you don't have total control, do you? Do you or I have total control of everything around us? We do not. Nobody does. If you allow this understanding in your heart, you'll have total peace. Continuing in the dream, this decision is announced by messengers. The Holy One declares the verdict so that the living may know the Most High is sovereign over the kingdoms of men, and he gives them to anyone he wishes and sets over them the lowliest of men. Wow, this is full of meaning. The whole purpose of the book of Daniel is one purpose. It is summarized in this statement. So that the living may know, not just King Nebuchadnezzar, but so that all human beings may know. What is it that we are supposed to know? That the Most High is sovereign. Know that God is in total control. The Most High is sovereign. That means everything that happens in this world is under His sovereignty, under His complete control over the kingdoms of men. And he, God, gives the kingdoms of men to anyone he wishes. Satan told Jesus, I'll give you all of this. I give it to whoever I wish. That's not true. He's a liar. He's not in control. The Bible says here in Daniel that God is in control. So you have a choice to make. Who's in control of this world anyway? God or forces of evil? God or humanity? God or climate change? God. Is God in control, or are you in control of your life? You're not in control. You and I are not in control. Acts, where Paul the Apostle goes in front of the Athenians in Greece, where Socrates and Plato and all of the philosophers were at. He said, in him we live and move and have our being. And he has appointed the exact times and dates that you and I would live in. You're not in control even of the time that God decided that you would live in. He could have decided that you and I would have been born 1,000 years ago or 1,000 years into the future. He decided that you would be alive right now, 2022. He is in control. This is the theme of the book of Daniel. Put this on your memory verse list. The living must know that the Most High is sovereign over the kingdoms of men, and he gives them to anyone he wishes. It's interesting during the political campaigns and seasons that we're in that everybody always claims that this is the most important election of all human history, and if we don't elect the right people into office, we're going to see the end of the world. whatever. There's all this alarmism all over the place. I do know this, after having lived many, many years in the world, where we have a place where we get to vote a little bit, have a little bit of influence into who's in charge, that it doesn't really matter who's in charge. It does matter, but it doesn't matter. It matters because the people that are in charge should make decisions that are for the benefit of all. If they don't, then we all suffer. Yes, I understand that voting is important, and yes, I understand that political leadership is a battle. However, no political party, no political leader has total control of anything. They are not the solution to all of the things that we face, to inflation, to health problems, to mental problems. No one has all of the answers, only God. We need to come to that. When you do come to this, you'll have peace. Too many Christians that I have seen over the past few years have gotten so frantic and so fed up with everything going on in the world that they're paranoid. They read too much stuff on the internet. The internet is good and it's bad. It's good in that it gives you information. It's bad in that it gives you information. Because information, whether it's right or wrong, is difficult to determine. You need to be careful how much stuff you download into your head, because some of the stuff you can't even handle anyway. What can you and I do about things that happen on the other side of the world? We can only really pay attention to the parameters that God has given us. Okay, so let's be careful. God is sovereign. He's in control, unless you don't think so. Now, the truth of God, it's not always encouraging. The truth. It's not always an encouraging thing, because the truth of God is stark. It is sometimes very black and white. It's almost like the edge of a sword. The truth of God is sometimes a painful thing, because truth is truth. And people would rather believe something that is not true than to believe the painful truth that is reality. Who wants to hear the truth that the doctor tells you? You have cancer. I knew a guy that the doctor told him that, and he says, "Nah, I don't believe it. I'm going to go home." He went home. He didn't do anything about it. He died within a year. We don't like to hear certain truths that are true because they're scary. And so we sometimes decide, nah, don't want to hear it. Bye. Don't talk to me. I don't want to hear that. You can't run away from truth. The Bible is full of truth. There's good elements in truth, and there are more difficult elements in truth. Some of the more difficult elements in the truth of the Bible are: we have all sinned. We have all fallen short of the glory of God. We are all rebels by nature. We are all shake our fists in the face of God and say, "I don't like you. I don't like this life that you gave to me." We are all infected with the same thing: disbelief and rebel spirits against the one true God. But there's also the positive of God has decided to make peace with the rebels, and God has decided to take the blame of all of the things that they've done wrong and take unto himself all of the sin of the whole world, if we'll listen. So continuing, this dream that I, King Nebuchadnezzar, had, this is the dream, Daniel. Now, tell me what it means. For none of the other wise men in my kingdom can interpret it for me, but you can, because the spirit of the holy gods is in you. So he knows who Daniel is. He knows that Daniel has a relationship with this being called God. He knows this about this man. And that's why you and I are in the world. That's why Daniel's not the king, but Nebuchadnezzar is the king. Why? Because Daniel's life is going to be influential in the life of a pagan king, so that he will come to the place where he himself will say, "There is one God. I believe in him, and I will follow him." Continuing, Daniel was greatly perplexed for a time. His thoughts terrified him. So the king said, "Belshazzar, don't let the dream and its meaning alarm you." Belshazzar answered, "My lord, if only this dream applied to your enemies and its meaning to your adversaries." So Daniel knows what it means. He understands the import of the dream. He understands it. Give people the good news first. Now, a lot of people tell the doctors, "Okay, I want the bad news first." In human relationships and in tactfulness, when it says Daniel had wisdom and tact, give people good news first. Give it to them and encourage them first. There's a lot of bad news in this world. There's a lot of negativity in this world. We need to tell people about God's love. We need to tell people about God's forgiveness. We need to show and offer to people that this is free and that you don't need to earn it. You don't need to do religious weird stuff for it. You can have God's love. You can have God's forgiveness free and without charge. But at the same time, once people do accept this, we need to start sharing with them all of the whole counsel of God so that they hear everything about what God says about sin and about forgiveness and about damnation, about life and death and everything else. But give people good news first. Too many Christians run around with a sign, the end of the world and God is coming and boy, is he mad and he's going to throw everybody in hell. And boy, that really causes lots of people to turn to God, doesn't it? No, it doesn't. What causes people to turn to God is the attraction to the sweetness of God. Come and taste that the Lord is good, says one of the prophets. So we are telling people, come, we have found the Lord. He's good. He's full of goodness and love and forgiveness. Yes, he's also the judge of the universe. Yes, he sits on a throne of glory and he commands life and death. But you need to understand first and foremost that what motivates him primarily is love and concern for his created people. The tree you saw, which grew large and strong with its top touching the sky, visible to the whole earth, with beautiful leaves and abundant fruit, providing food for all, giving shelter to the beasts of the field, and having nesting places in its branches for the birds of the air. You, O King, are that tree. Well, that sounds good. Again, just like the other one. You're the head of gold. You're the tree. You become great and strong. Your greatness has grown until it reaches the sky. Your dominion extends to distant parts of the earth. Remember, I told you, all the way to touching what was going to become the Roman Empire. He controlled all the way to Greece. He controlled all the way to Egypt, all the way to the borders of India, Afghanistan, all the way to the Black Sea, the Baltic Sea, all of the Middle East. He controlled all of that, okay? Now, he had become great, and Daniel's identifying him as the tree. But we know from the rest of the dream that there's a real negative part. Life here on earth, it can never be without complications. It can never be without trial and difficulty and struggle. Life is full of these things. None of us live life without. Who have you ever met that has sidestepped all of the difficulties of life? Do you know anyone? I don't. I have met very, very rich and successful people who their families and their marriages are a wreck. I know very, very highly educated people and their lives are a wreck. I know very, very poor people and their lives are a wreck. All of us lives, we all face challenges and we all go up and down with success and failure. No one is exempted. Everybody faces things. Some people think that I'll just get myself fit and I won't use drugs, I won't smoke, I won't do alcohol, I'll be totally on top of the world, and boom, they get hit with something and they find out that they're mortal and that they don't have control of even their own bodies. There was a lady that used to come here to church years ago. Her name was Margaret Weir. She told me, I'm so glad that God gave me MS. And I go, why, Margaret? Because it was a horrible disease. When you first get the diagnosis, it's because you start getting weak and having fatigue and having joint pains and muscle spasms. And then eventually when the diagnosis is officially given, it starts to really progress. Soon you're not able to walk really good. Soon you have to get into a wheelchair. Soon you have to get into assisted living. And soon, because MS takes away even the basic functions of the body, you can't even breathe on your own. And so she did die. But she told me, you know what, I'm glad that this happened to me. Do you know why? Because when everything was going good for me, when I had total health and I wasn't facing any challenge, I didn't believe in God. I didn't believe that I needed to have God in my life. But because MS came into my life and because God used it to make me humble, I came to faith, I came to church, I came to the Bible. I opened my heart up to the Lord and I put belief in him. And she died. She died of MS. But she's alive forevermore because the Bible says, he who believes in me, even if he dies, he shall live. I watched her die. My wife and I and her family were inside of the intensive care unit at the end of her life and we watched her die. But she had a belief in the Lord God, and she's okay now. Here's the dream. Here's the interpretation. You, O king, saw a messenger, a holy one, coming down from heaven, saying, cut down the tree. Remember, you are the tree, O king. So the holy one, the angel, says, cut it down. Cut down, King Nebuchadnezzar, and destroy it. Destroy the tree. Destroy everything that he has made of himself. But leave the stump, bound with iron and bronze, in the grass of the field, while its roots remain in the ground. Let him be drenched with the dew of heaven. Let him live like the wild animals until 7 years pass by for him. So, this is the message of the first part of Nebuchadnezzar's conversion to the Lord. And next week we'll pick up the rest of it, and it's really, really amazing. So, the lessons in this are for all of us. The lessons in this are for all humanity. There is a God. He is in total control. He gives sovereignty and control in life, in the temporal world, to those whom he wishes, whether you voted for them or not, by the way. And our job as believers is to pray for them and to ask God to help them. You know, it's interesting to me that I'm listening to many Christians who laugh at Joe Biden because he's old and because he's suffering the beginnings of possible dementia. I don't know. I'm not his doctor. And I'm thinking to myself, but the Bible tells us to pray for those who are in places of leadership. Pray for them. It's a sin to laugh at somebody when they struggle. It's a sin to rejoice when somebody fails. It's a sin. The Bible says that. It's a sin. Do not rejoice when your enemy falters and fails, because the same thing could happen to you, it says in the book of Proverbs. So we need to be careful of being so petty that we would, and because we don't like the guy that's in charge or the gal, whoever it is, that we would laugh at them and that we would talk evil of them. Be careful of that, Christians. God didn't call you into the world for that purpose. God called you into the world to serve him, to love him, to be an example of someone who trusts in him, even if it means life and death. Thank you, Lord God, for the message of Nebuchadnezzar the king in the book of Daniel. Thank you that through the faithfulness of Daniel and his fellow Jewish exiles, they were able to influence a pagan king who had conquered the whole known world. And in that influence, this pagan king becomes a brother in the kingdom of God. And when we go into eternity, we get to meet Nebuchadnezzar personally. We get to talk to him about the day that he decided to throw the Jewish people into the furnace. We get to talk to him about how he came to understand who God was, because God had to make him into a madman first before he became a sane man. Now in Jesus' name, Lord, take the word of God into the people of God for their benefit. Amen.
Thank you so much for being a part of Grace Community Church's virtual service today. We hope that you found the encouragement you were looking for. We hope you share these videos with your friends and family. And please drop us a note. Let us know if you're still watching them so that we can continue making them for you. Thank you so much. Click like, subscribe, and we'll see you next time.